you can do, like I said, take a look, see how your pages are looking, both on your mobile, laptop, also tablets, iPads. Test, test, test. Images work well for some nonprofits. Copy works better for other nonprofits. Your number of form fields. These are all variables that you should be testing on a regular basis. I hate when I go to presentations and someone's like, great news, everybody. Positive images perform better than negative images. And I'm always thinking like, well, for your list, for your cause, on a Tuesday at 2 o'clock. So I really encourage everyone to treat their list differently and experiment to see what resonates the best with your particular audience. One thing that has really proven useful for a lot of our nonprofit clients are the one-click donations and advocacy appeals. So if I get an email and it says, Dear Maureen, please make a donation, and I click that button, when I'm taken to the donation form, my name, my address, my credit card, if I so desire, is already pre-populated in there, so that's just a click away. It has a lot higher conversion rate compared to when you have to enter all that data manually. So that's something that Engaging Networks offers through our software, and it may be that your CM offers that as well. One thing I'll call out as special that not everybody does is if I, Maureen, receive that email and I forward to my friend Betty, if Betty then clicks on that donation, not all of my information is going to appear for her. That breaks when I forward it to a friend. So it's another way of protecting your data and your privacy. Anybody know who these guys are? It's Journey. So supporter journeys can mean a lot of things. For the purpose of this presentation, I'm talking about, and again, purpose of this conference for a bigger picture, is turning activists into donors, donors into activists. Welcome series are treated as supporter journeys as well. It can mean a lot of different things. But what I'm talking about is taking your activists and encouraging them to become donors. Specifically, where these stats are related, it's on the success page of an action. So I've emailed my prime minister on an issue I care about. I'm taken to a page and it says, Maureen, thanks for doing that to really drive this point home. Can you donate $10 now? So I have a pet peeve where, as an activist, if I click on an action page and nothing happens, I don't know if my letter went through, I don't know if I should do it again. I think it's very lazy for a nonprofit to not be thoughtful about what happens after that supporter clicks submit. So a few choices you have are, sometimes you get redirected to a homepage. I would call that the lowest thing you could do. At least I know that something happened. I have gone somewhere, a thing has taken place on this website. A much better thing to do is a thank you message. So thank you, Maureen, for taking action. So direct, do nothing, direct to a homepage, thank you message. The step above that, which is something I encourage you guys to do, is to then make it a donation ask or a share ask. And not just a simple, please donate, please share. It's, I took action on stopping puppy mills. I should be asked to donate to stop puppy mills and not just support an organization's mission as a larger issue. It should be tied to the action that I'm taking. So of our clients that did this, that took their success page of an action and embedded a donation ask in that, we saw 4% completing that donation. The good news is that it's a low number, but it's an increase from 2015. So our worst performing client that did that got half of 1% conversion rate on that. But that still, half a percent, resulted in nearly $2,000 in the bank account of that nonprofit for a very, very low level ask in terms of effort and what they needed to do on their side to make that happen. So almost $2,000 just by implementing that. Conversely, our top performing client got almost 8%. They saw $30,000 of revenue from those embedded donation asks after the action page. So you're just leaving money on the table if you're not doing that. Here's Greenpeace. As you can see, both on the desktop version and the mobile version, I have taken action to stop funding new coal, and I'm being prompted on both of these to chip in a donation ask, or given the choice to do a social media ask, so Facebook and Twitter call outs right there. And you can see on the desktop version, we have picture, we have copy, we're taking advantage of the increased real estate, whereas compared to the mobile device, it's a much shorter and sweeter message with a lot bigger buttons. Retention. Now, I was just in a session with Chris from Chris Carter Marketing, who said that the average retention rate was 45%, according to a study done in the US. Still low as far as I'm concerned, but not as low as the numbers we saw, which I thought were the most horrifying part of this number crunching. Only 27% of the donors that gave to our clients in 2015 gave again in 2016. And even less than that were the activists, which were about 25% of repeat activists. Any thoughts as to why these numbers might be so low? I don't know. The answer is I don't know, but these numbers are surprising and disappointing.
Bad data.
How about the data? However, ray of light, for the clients that did try to engage their donors with activist activities and their activists with donor activities, we did see a 4% higher level of retention. So deepening the engagement by not keeping those supporters in their separate tracks resulted in overall better engagement among the charity and their supporter base, which is what this whole day is about. So our poorest performing client had only 8%, and this is for donations, 8% donated from 2015 and then again in 2016. I think that's a very clear example of some bad practices and bad follow-up and bad thank yous. Whereas our top performing client had 48%, which is much more respectable and higher than the average that was quoted in the last session. New supporters. The point I want to make too in terms of those retention rates are that you really need to focus on your current supporters and not just always think about getting new supporters. You need to be grateful for the ones you have, treat them with respect, and then look to new supporters as an important priority, but not as important as retaining the ones you already have. I've seen a lot of presentations, and the ones that do the cost breakdown are always say, it's cheaper to keep what you have than to get the new ones. So it's something to keep in mind. So again, looking at 2015 to 2016, we saw petition takers go down, but we saw email to target go up. Any thoughts on why that may be? My personal opinion, again, like I was saying, that nonprofits are being smarter about asking for recurring gifts versus single gifts. I think supporters are a little bit smarter, knowing that petitions are not nearly as effective as actual email to targets. So it's one thing to say, you know, I pledge to support childhood education. That's great, but it's a much more effective action if they are emailing their elected representatives saying there should be increased funding for schools. So I think our supporters are getting smarter, and I think that's one of the reasons why that advocacy is increasing, but overall petitions are down. And again, like I was saying with the donations, I think the nonprofits are just being a little more explicit and aggressive, asking for those monthly donations, and supporters are responding to that. In terms of your homepage signup, everyone have homepage signups? Good. Our worst performing client got 300 new supporters last year from including a homepage signup, whereas our top performing got 3,000, which again strikes me as a little low. I think that's because most of the new supporters are coming in through the donations, through the advocacy. The sign up, the stay informed, subscribes, those are just a nice add-on. Here is an example of one of our clients that has a whole lot of asks to join. So this is the London Cycling Campaign. You can see a front and center join LCC, big and bold and red right in the middle there. And then I'm not sure how well you can read it, but kind of all over that page, it's become a member, sign up, donate. Trying to see if there's any other. There's a lot going on. And I think a lot of times nonprofits get in the mindset of, we need to be really news focused and news driven, and we need every time our supporters to come to our homepage for there to be a new blog or a new RSS feed, new tweets. We want to show that there's a lot of activity and talk about a lot what's going on. I believe that most of the supporters that are coming to your homepage are going to be new supporters. And so it's more important to tell the story of your organization, your mission, what you're working on within that homepage, and to have a lot of acquisition asks. So the signups, the donates, the take action. Whereas your current supporters, I don't see a lot of them going to your homepage on a whim, wanting to check in with how you as an organization are doing. If they're going to your website, it's typically in response to an email or some other direct ask from your organization, and you can take them to a individual page. So here's this really important event that's coming up that you should check out. You're going right to that page. It's not as important for that to be accessed on the homepage, or hey, we just got this great news story written about us in this newspaper, check it out. That doesn't have to be on your homepage. That can be emailed to your supporters and go to an interior page. So I encourage you to look at your homepage through the lens of the new supporters rather than the returning supporters. Engagement scoring. So this is a fancy thing that Engaging Networks does for you. We, instead of you running reports to see how engaged your supporters are, we've set up a scale to kind of mark them automatically. So low scores are very active, ones and twos and threes. High scores, eight, nines and tens, not so active. And these are kind of broken down in terms of, have they opened an email, have they made a donation, have they taken an action, and so that number, those numbers are always front and center. Those aren't something you have to run reports on. So what we're seeing, again, those low numbers are good scores. The reason this was not for a full year 2016 and a full year 2015 is because we just introduced it last year. So we don't have a lot of numbers. Instead, we took snapshots of what were the numbers in March of 2016 and then February of this past year. Yes?
Sorry, quick question. Do you do that score at the individual record level?
Yes.
And update it?
Yes. So among the really highly engaged, we saw about 8% when we first released it. Down a little bit to 6.5% almost a full year later. And then the numbers are fairly consistent going down the list. What really struck us, again, bad news, about 50% of a nonprofit's email list was inactive. Not opening the emails, not taking action, not making donations, which may be a hint as to why those retention scores were so low. But the level of engagement just really isn't there. in terms of email frequency and quantity, we have a lot to say about this. I will say, we looked at our 20 top performing clients, and we found that they're sending about 20 emails a year per person. Compare that to our 20 worst performing clients, they were sending about 7 emails per person. So I think it comes as no surprise that the higher amount of emails resulted in more engaged supporters, whereas a lower volume of emails resulted in less engaged supporters. Compared to that average, our best performing client had nearly 50%, well, 46.8, but I'm rounding up. Almost half their list had an engagement score of 1, so super highly engaged. They send an average of 96.3 emails per person per year. I encourage you guys to try different levels of volume. I'm not saying, don't go back to your boss and say, we need to start sending 96 emails.
Whatever, that's just twice a week. That's nothing.
Twice a week is not bad, right? That's totally doable. But I think you should keep an eye on your own subscribe rates and look at your own list and your own performance. I'm just making the point that a client that sent a whole lot of emails had a tremendously high engagement score compared to our average.
Totally, and if they unsubscribed, you didn't want them anyways.
That's right, there you go. And only 27% of their file was inactive. Compared to our worst performing client, so 1.5% of their list had that top highly engaged score. It's probably the employees of the organization, right? So we see a 12.9 emails per person. I'm thinking a monthly newsletter and maybe one year-end appeal, and that's what that 12.9 was. And 54% of their file was inactive, no activity for the past year. Tip. As I said, there is obviously a correlation between high volume of email, high level of engagement, low volume of email, low level of engagement. But I want to make the point loud and clear that it's less about the frequency and more about the content. It's important to be delivering relevant content to your list in a compelling manner, segmenting them in a way that they're getting what's interesting to them and what's worthy of sending. Another surprising thing we noticed is I feel like you expect small email file lists to have higher levels of engagement, right? Maybe it's a new organization, maybe it's really specific, maybe it's, you know, a school community in this one city, they're going to be highly engaged. However, what we found is it was pretty even. So 10% of our clients with the biggest lists, over a million records, we're seeing, again, that 54% inactive. And then the smallest lists, down to 6,700 records, still about half of their list was inactive. So that was a surprising result to us. Whereas the bigger organizations had a list roughly as engaged as some of the smaller organizations. One thing I will say, for a software provider like Engaging Networks, we charge based on the size of your email list. So if you are carrying a lot of dead data, I encourage you guys to hire someone like Chris Carter Marketing to help you get rid of that data so that you can have a much more accurate and engaged list and that you're not paying to store those records that you don't need anymore. So for Engaging Networks, if you have a list of a million people, but only 100,000 of them are subscribed, our system still needs to look at all million of those records before the email goes out, and you pay for that. Whereas if you have just the 100,000 ones that are still subscribed in there, we're only looking at them before we send, and that's what you're paying for. So just emphasizing the point of data hygiene and keeping your list relevant and up to date, and getting rid of supporters that haven't taken action, opened an email, made a donation, and just a few notes about average gift size. Converted this to Canadian dollars to make it nice and easy. So in the UK, we had about $66 for an average donation. In the US, $120 for a single average donation. And Canadian came out on top with $157.56 average donation. So good job on that, guys. Compared to a recurring gift, US came out slightly ahead in this one. UK had $16.50. The US had the $35 in the Canadian, and Canada had almost $25. So Canadian dollars are in the lead for the single gift, but not the monthly recurring gift. Closing slide. Some things we talked about today that I hope you remember. If nothing else, mobile optimize. Your homework assignment, look at those pages and then institute the changes. And make sure you take a snapshot of your performance before any of those changes, so you can have a true account of what improvement you're seeing just as a direct result of that. For these supporter journeys, after the action page, looked for specific and timely donation asks or sharing asks. I encourage you guys to treat your current supporters well and not just be on the quest for new supporters. As we talked about, I think actions are proving to be more compelling than just petition signatures, and monthly giving is on the rise compared to single gifts. Sign-up asks on your homepage are a small but important thing to do. Keep an eye on your email file size and get rid of any records that don't need to be there. And make sure you're emailing often, and I think I made up the word relevantly. But that's just as important as the amount you're sending as what you're sending. And we've got some time to spare. Emails, I would encourage you to send more than one on the same issue always. So to send it out 3 days later, no response, send it again 2 days later. A lot of times we'll see the fourth or fifth email in a series outperforming the first and second. So reminder, sometimes it takes people a few asks for them to commit to it. In terms of, I would think it would depend on the nonprofit, but I don't have that information.
Going back to the beginning with the numbers around mobile, mm-hmm. How does that compare to the actual amount of traffic on mobile? Because we're seeing the percent taking action and the percent taking donating. But I would imagine the actual people coming in via mobile is higher than that.
Yeah, so these are just the completion rates, mm-hmm. and not the overall traffic. I do not know the answer to that either. The problem is we crunched these numbers in like February, right at year end, and I was involved in those conversations, but it's been a while since we talked through the protocol of how we came upon them, so I apologize. Well, we can call it here. I'm going to stick around. If you guys have any questions about engaging networks specifically, I'm happy to answer them. And hope to see everyone at the after party.